Hello everyone, how are you doing? Welcome back to another guide for Absent Zero. So we're finally done with deck building, and we are going to go over the basic plays of the deck. Excuse me. It's going to be a long video, I promise you guys that right now. I'm going to go over the basic plays, of course, but I'm going to go into great detail what's a good play, what's a bad play. Excuse me again. I keep burping, sorry. What you want to look out for, and what you want to focus on. Especially this will tie into today's meta choices, and today's meta deck as well. These basics will at least help you on how to fight against those decks as well. Anyway, let's get started. I think the number one thing I had problematic things I came across when running a deck was how to use Stratos. Now, Stratos is really simple. He searches out everything. But the thing is that you want to go, that comes the question is, what do you want to search out? And let's go over my Destiny draw engine. So these are my cards and the D draws as well. So let's say opening first turn you have Strauss but no D draw. What do you do? Well, what a lot of inexperienced players like to do, and what I did as well, was that I'd search out Diamond Dude. Now the mentality behind this was because, okay, well, I'm not going to search out Malicious, because if I'm not out of a Destiny draw, I'm not going to search out Malicious. I mean, he's a dead card anyway, why do I want to search him out? I'd rather search out Diamond Dude. So that way, when I summon him, I could possibly hit that Destiny draw instead. If not, I'm just going to go and overlay into rank 4, or I can just go for big damage. Basic mentality. You know, that's not a bad play. Honestly, it's a good play, but not for first turn. What you want to do first, if you're in this position, which you will run into a lot, by the way, or sometimes, but you're going to run into this situation where you don't, when you have a Strauss and you don't have a Destiny draw. You want to search out Malicious first. You want to set Malicious up as fast as possible. Now, looking at what we have left in the deck, we have 3 D heroes and 3 Destiny draws. So, looking at it from this angle, we have a fair chance of drawing either a D hero or a Destiny draw. However, if we're looking at this from the Malicious aspect, we have 3 Destiny draws and 1 Malicious. So, we have a higher chance of drawing to the Destiny draw rather than drawing into Malicious. And when we draw into Destiny draw, we're instantly set up for Malicious. And if we've been saving up our resources, we might draw into a D.Va. But we don't have to worry about if we went for the Diamond Dude play. We won't have to now worry about, okay, now I have to get Malicious and I have to get Destiny draw in my hand. Just to use Malicious, I mean, there's other ways to send Malicious to the graveyard, but Destiny draw, in my opinion, is probably the best way to take advantage of a Malicious. Now, the final card I want to go over is Doomlord. Now, throughout this whole time in the guide, when we were building our deck, not once did I say, run this card or don't run this card. This card's good, this card's bad. I never said that because I want you guys to explore and, you know, try new things. If I told you what was good and what was bad, you're not going to test what's bad, you're only going to use what's good. So this is where you guys can, you know, find your own things. And this is the one time in the guide where I'm actually telling you, or at least suggesting you, to run a card, and that is Doomlord. The reason is because Doomlord really handles a lot of threats we can't, especially in this meta right now. E-Dragons, look at Big Eye, Dragosack. Those Xyz monsters are really hard to get over. Doomlord takes care of that for us. Now, there's other cards as well. Ophion from Evil Swarms. Ophion shuts down a lot of our plays. Doomlord takes care of it. Crimson Blader is another thing. 28 is really hard to get over for the deck, and we'd rather not make it Absolute Zero, because even then, if we ram Absolute Zero into a Crimson Blader, we are still stunned from bringing out any high-level monsters, so Doomlord will take care of all those things. As for how to properly use Doomlord, the number one thing you have to think about is when you summon Doomlord, you have to accept the fact he's going to die. Not only that, you also have to think 2 turns ahead, because when you summon Doomlord, he only temporarily takes care of that threat. And I mean, so you have to prepare yourself for, okay, well, how am I going to get rid of that monster 2 turns from now? Also, when you use Doomlord effect, you are giving your opponent recovery time because you can't attack that turn. If you were able to attack that turn, Doomlord would be much better, but you can't. So, you have to be very careful when using Doomlord. I'm sorry I'm being so vague, but the best way to learn how to use Doomlord is to make mistakes. In fact, learning how to play the whole deck, the best way to learn is to make mistakes. So you know how to use a certain card. But especially Doomlord, make mistakes. That's basically the best way to learn how to use Doomlord. I can't tell you how to use him. I can only tell you make mistakes. Which I've said way too many times. Anyway, next is D.Va. D.Va is one of our, is basically the one card in our deck that focuses on the basic, focuses on our deck's win condition. Basically, the way we play the deck is to eat up resources, take advantage of that, go aggro, and win. D.Va is the number one card that takes this aspect and really abuses it. So, when you play D.Va, there's two things you want to look for when summoning her. That is either a synchro body on the field or a malicious in the graveyard. Most likely it's going to be malicious in the graveyard, so we're going to focus on malicious. So, when you have this, when you have a malicious in the graveyard, a D.Va in hand, you've set up to the point where no matter what, you are going to either make a good one for one or you're going to plus off of it. But before we get into that play and explaining about it, first we have to learn how to do the play. So, you know, it's really simple. Bring out D.Va, bring out Malicious, synchro into your level 8. You know, it's really simple. How can you mess that up? Actually, that's pretty easy to mess up. So, let's say they have something like a Bombless set. All right. No, not Boundless. That's too easy because you're just going to make Stardust. Let's say Torrential. How can you play out Torrential if you only have a D.Va in hand with no back row destruction and a Malicious? Now, this is only if you run Lost Brew Breaker, so I do apologize if you don't run Lost Brew Breaker, but this is one of the core plays D.Va likes to focus on. So, let's say they have a set Torrential. We know it. How can we get rid of it? Well, what a lot of inexperienced players like to do, and again, what I did myself, was bring out Malicious, because my thinking was, okay, so now they're going to know I'm going to synchro with it. I might as well get rid of their synchro body. But they won't. Logically speaking, they won't. In your own fantasy world, you know, it will happen, but honestly, they won't. They'll just wait until you bring out the tuner, and then they will torrential. You're down two cards. You're down your normal summon. You're down your D.Va and your Malicious, and they only use a torrential. What you want to do instead is you want to summon D.Va, and from here, this is where you have the most control. What you can do is you could summon D.Va, bring out another copy of D.Va, then overlay into a Gachi. But you're still going to end up getting torrential when you summon another copy of D.Va. You could summon D.Va, bring out Lost Brew Breaker, synchro into Librarian, but you're still going to fall into the same problem. So you could see the biggest problem with the deck is, you know, the biggest problem with this play is trying to get around that trap card or trying to get around your opponent's face downs. The easiest way to do this is by summoning D.Va to make bring out Lost Brew Breaker. Now from here, if your opponent knows what you're playing and they're smart enough, they'll use Torrential Tribute. But if they have something they want to save on the field, they're most likely not going to do it, so you're going to be safe. What you're going to do next is you're going to use Lost Brew Breaker's effect to pop the face down, which we know, of course, is Torrential Tribute. We don't have to worry about Torrential Tribute anymore. We just use Malicious Effect, then we synchro. We've eaten up a card, and we've made a big level 8 monster. Now, as for what synchros you want to go into, most of the time you're going to make Stardust first, because you want to protect your resources. Of course, Scrap Dragon, if you understand how to use it, Colossal Fighter, or whatever level 8 monsters you use in your deck, you should understand when to drop them. But if you don't know what you want to go for, make Stardust. Stardust is basically the safest play you can go for, and one of the best plays as well. So now that you know how to properly use a D.Va, there's actually a bad way of using her. Now, let's say we don't have that set up for either a Malicious in the graveyard or wants their body to synchro with. What does summoning a diva, you know, what does that open up? Well, first off, it opens up the vulnerability of getting veilered. You can thank mermails, but you can also blame them for making diva such a big target for cards such as veiler. Because once you do this, you can't just banish a malicious in your graveyard to bring another copy. Because, you know, see this is why if you had the malicious in the graveyard and they waste a veiler, doesn't matter, go level 8. But since you didn't have that, what's your only other way of taking advantage? Well, leaving it on the field. That's honestly the best option. What some people like to do is once they do this play, they like to follow up with the miracle fusion play, which, you know, in a sense makes sense because, you know, you're bringing out something like a 25 beater rather than leaving 200 on the field. But you are going out of your way to make a absolute zero, which is wrong. Which we'll get into a miracle fusion after we cover up diva, which are almost done. So you never want to do that. It's better just leave diva on there, leave diva by herself. And a reason you want to know that is because sometimes you're going to find yourself in situations where you have to summon a diva even if you don't have the requirements of malicious in the graveyard and a synchro body on the field. Sometimes you have to go for those games. Sometimes you have to go for the diva play even if you don't have the most control right now, or if you don't have those conditions. So the next card to cover is Miracle Fusion. Now Miracle Fusion is probably the easiest card to misplay. The reason is because a lot of people like to associate Miracle Fusion with Elemental Heroes. Elemental Heroes like to use their fusion monsters. They like to, you know, abuse Bulbman as well, depending on what variant, but most of the time they like to abuse their fusion monsters. We don't like abusing our fusion. We don't like abusing Miracle Fusion at all. Our number one rule of thumb when playing this deck, especially when playing our cards, even more so Miracle Fusion, is to use it because we have to. Not because we can. Because we have to or we need to. That's just how all of our plays are based off of. Do I need to use this card now? No. Do I need to use this card now? Yes. That's how you judge all your plays. But Miracle Fusion is one, again, the easiest things to misplay. I've seen players go for a Miracle Fusion play just to make a zero, follow up with their second Miracle Fusion in hand to go for another zero just to pop the field. Now, this is acceptable play when you're going for game, but if you're doing it just because you want to clear the board, no. It's better just to ram your absolute zero into their monsters rather than wasting a Miracle Fusion. It's honestly not something you want to do. I've seen someone use a Miracle Fusion to go into absolute zero. The opponent had two face downs on the field and two face down monsters and one set card. They tribute summon for Caius just so they can get rid of that one face down card. No. You love that part. You love it when your opponent has a face down and they're playing defense, because you know you're using Absolute Zero correctly. What you want to look out for when using Absolute Zero is, first off, you don't want to summon Absolute Zero when your opponent has face down cards on the field and they have no monsters, or they have one monster that you don't really care about, because they can just simply one for one away. Any of these cards are just going to one for one that absolute zero, and you're going to be sad because you wasted an absolute zero. Your opponent doesn't have to worry about it. You want to summon absolute zero when your opponent has really invested a lot on the board, and summoning something like an absolute zero is so frustrating for the opponent because they have to figure out, okay, what losses can I take? Basic rule of thumb with absolute zero, the other one, is never go out of your way to make an absolute zero. Always make it so that your opponent will have to go out of their way to get rid of your absolute zero. So yeah, keep that in mind. And finally, we're gonna go over Dark Arm Dragon. I mean, he's really simple to learn and how to play. I'm not gonna go over that. I mean, you know, this is easy. But there are ways to really make your Dark Arm, to make a Dark Arm Dragon secret. Not secret rare, but make it a secret you have Dark Arm Dragon. Sorry for that lame pun, or if it was a pun, but... So, number one thing is you're going to be checking your graveyard a lot if you have three darks. So this is where you want to play the memory game. You want to be able to remember how many darks are in your graveyard at all times, and also what you can do to adjust it. Now, there are ways to get around this and make your opponent think that you don't have Dark Arm Dragon in hand when you do. That is by using cards like Miracle Fusion to check when you go for Absolute Zero play. Monster Reborn. And finally, Malicious. Excuse me. When you're using cards like these, you'll be able to not only take advantage of the play you're doing right now, but you're also able to constantly check if you have Dark Arm Dragon or not. So this is a really cool trick to masking you have a Dark Arm Dragon while still going for your normal plays. So that when it gets to a point, when you know that when you've dropped Dark Arm Dragon good, you've done a good job of masking your Dark Arm Dragon, when you drop this guy and your opponent immediately grabs your graveyard and checks it, it's even more amazing when your opponent checks something like, let's say, a Malicious and a Diamond Dude, and they're like, dude, you only have two darks. And then you're like, Hyper Librarian is a dark monster. It's just the satisfaction of hiding a Dark Arm Dragon, and also how to mask it is just really fun, and it's a really cool tip. So anyway, hopefully you guys learned a little bit more on how to use the deck. The best advice I can do when learning these four basic plays is to, first of all, make mistakes. Making mistakes is good. You'll be able to know why this play doesn't work, instead of me saying, you know, this is bad, and you won't be able to really learn. But you need to know these basic plays, is make mistakes so you'll learn, okay, so this is why he said this is a bad play. Make mistakes. Second is to always keep this in mind with every play you do. What can I try to extend your resources out as much as possible. We're playing the game of eat resources, take advantage, go for game. So whenever you go for a play, you always want to ask yourself, do I need to do this? If you don't need to, don't. If you need to, or if you're reading something that your opponent may have, you might want to consider, or you have to go, or you may want to go for it. But anyway, hopefully you guys learned something from this, and I'll see you in the next video. And we're going to cover side decking. So until then, see you guys.